On these humble pages, scientific inquiries stack one upon the next to form a magnificent castle of human knowledge. Flu, the Great Migration.
We're looking at how flu moves about the world, and we're trying to trace back where viruses come from.
In a new study, Trevor Bedford and his colleagues investigate the lifestyles and travel habits of flu to understand the origin of outbreaks. Think of it. When millions come down with a strain of flu,
someone existed in the world that had the flu, and that now everyone that has the flu descends from that one sneeze. We don't know that person, obviously, but we can establish the region that they lived in.
Trevor says the person who sneezed the sneeze that would give rise to flu season,
that person was most likely and usually in South China and India or in Southeast Asia.
You might be thinking, wow, that's crazy.
Yes, it is.
Trevor compared the genetic material, the RNA, of flu samples from all over the world and put together a giant family tree of flu, which Trevor agreed to recreate using paper and pipe cleaners.
I mean, this is my level of abstraction anyway. It's fine.
Think of each circle as a flu sample.
Here's the virus. Both of these viruses share a common ancestor here. This virus actually seeded kind of two infections. Flu mutates, so a mutation has occurred. Subsequent people infected.
And this goes on.
How's that looking?
And on. Now, imagine almost 10,000 circles. That's the size of Trevor's tree, making it perhaps the largest study of flu evolution in history.
Yeah, depending on how you parse it, I think this is it.
What did the flu family tree reveal? That the life of flu has more twists than a pretzel factory.
So the biggest surprise is that influenza B behaves very differently from flu A.
You see, there are different kinds of flu. Flu A includes the strain H3N2. That was the most common and deadly strain of seasonal flu last year. And H3N2, Trevor found, leads a very different lifestyle from flu B.
So H3N2 evolves very quickly.
So your immunity to H3N2 doesn't last long. The flu evolves, escaping our immune system.
Then you'll get it every 5-10 years for the rest of your life.
Flu B lives a quieter life. It evolves more slowly. It infects a higher proportion of children who haven't been exposed to flu before.
Everyone gets it as a kid, but then you will have immunity to it for the next 20, 15 years.
These flus also travel differently, Trevor found. Flu B can settle for years in one place.
We can see one variant of B that sticks around Southeast Asia for 6 years and doesn't go anywhere else.
H3N2, on the other hand, travels faster than small town gossip, which was kind of mysterious. Why would H3N2 travel while flu B is stuck in one place? The answer? Airplanes. And the people who ride them.
Adults get on airplanes and travel around the world and spread flu, whereas flu B infects primarily children, and kids don't get on airplanes as much and don't spread the virus about the world as quickly.
Because flu B evolves more slowly and infects mostly kids, it travels when kids travel. Kids don't travel that much. H3N2 evolves more quickly, infects more adults, and hitches a ride with them all over the world. Trevor's data showed H3N2 often migrates from Southeast Asia, where flu circulates all year long. It heads to North America, where it deplanes, outcompetes local strains, and takes over. Knowing how different flus operate can help us make better vaccines. We could tailor B vaccines to specific regions, and H3N2's migration patterns tell us where to look for strains that dominate seasonal flu.
All of this, this geographic work kind of points you towards where in the world should we be picking our vaccine strains from.
Enigmas about this world are a dime a dozen, but with every study published, our view of the world gets a little more interesting. Until next time.